to come and
proclaim the word.
Amen.
Amen.
So it's a joy to welcome my wife to come and minister the word of the Lord. She does more than you just see here. She keeps our house together. Amen. She's a hard worker, and I can go on and on, but I know one time I was taking a shower. Amen. Taking a shower one time. And you know what the Lord told me? I was taking a shower. I take showers. I was taking a shower. And as I was taking a shower, the Lord reminded me that my wife is one of his riches in glory. And I've been meditating upon that word. You know. And so I thank God for her ministry, and please welcome Mrs. Pastor.
Thank you.
You can do a hand, at least you can give a hand.
Jesus.
was Jesus.
I glorify the Lord today.
Help me, Jesus.
Because it's not by might, it's not by power.
But by the Spirit.
Hallelujah, but by His Spirit.
Help me, Jesus.
This week, and my brother asked me this morning how my week has been. It has been challenging work-wise. Right now, I'm operating on only 4 hours of sleep. Something happened and I was asked to stay over until 2 o'clock until the AM, and I had to prepare for this. And, I almost bailed out. And the Lord said, no. The Lord said, no. Because it's not me who is giving the word, it's Him. When going gets tough,
it's not easy.
That's what they're tough.
By the Spirit of the Lord. Amen.
Yeah.
When Jesus came into the ark and he started his ministry, he called the disciples, the 12 that followed him, only the 12 that followed him. And as I was reading, these disciples had a very comfortable life when Jesus was walking with them. They had all they needed. They were walking with a man that was performing miracles, a man that was giving multiplying food, you know, just little food, and he makes it a lot, and people eating, there's leftovers. They were walking with somebody who was raising the dead. They were walking with somebody who was healing, making blind see and lame walk. They were doing good. They had a good reputation. They were doing good. They were walking with somebody that whenever they encountered any challenges, because of course they were getting criticized by the people of the world, he was there to encourage them and lift them. He was right there. Whatever they needed, they had it. They had it all. They were comfortable. They were in a comfortable, they were in whatever we can call comfort zone. Things were going well for them. That even when he was telling them that he is going to leave, they were not getting it. You know, you can be in a very comfortable position that even when you have warnings of things that something is going to happen, you're not seeing it because you're just comfortable. They were comfortable. They had Jesus right there. That even when he was telling them, I'm going to leave, I'm going to, and when I leave, I'm going to send you a comforter, it was not getting to them. They were just comfortable. They had somebody right there. They were like popular kids. You know, they were hanging out with this guy who was just doing things. And he did not call everybody. He just chose a few. So they saw themselves really doing really good. Really, really good. I haven't read anywhere that any one of them regretted when they were walking with Jesus, when he was on earth, they regretted walking with him.
Amen.
Until he was taken. He died, and they didn't see him anymore. To them, it was suddenly. Yesterday, we were working with this person, doing miracles, doing all these things, and today, he is gone. He is gone. These people had been called from somewhere, fishermen. You know, they were tax collectors. They had their own careers going, if you can say. And then he calls them, he works with them for 3 years, and boom, he goes. So where do we go from now? They were comfortable, they were doing good, and there he goes. There he goes. Even if he had prepared them, they were not getting it. They were not getting it, they were not hearing it. But suddenly to them, there he goes. Even before he went at the mountain of Transfiguration, the three of them even asked him, "Can we just stay up here? You know, it's so nice, it's so comfortable. You know, we can just live here." Because they just liked it, they just loved it. And suddenly, the man they knew, he died. And the way he died, it was painful, it was torture, it was... This is a man who was doing miracles, and all of a sudden they come and capture him, and he does not fight for himself. He does not say anything, he just keeps quiet. This man who was raising people from dead, they come and just capture him, they take his clothes off, they are beating him, he is carrying a heavy cross, he is walking a long way, he is staggering, and he is just not fighting them. He is just doing it. Like a sheep being led into the slaughterhouse. And he didn't fight. It's not written, but I can just, in my imagination, seeing them wonder, why are you not fighting? Why are you not doing the miracles that you used to do? Why are you not fighting for yourself? I can see the state of know, he was crucified and he died and he was put in a tomb. They went and hid themselves. They locked themselves up in a room for the fear of the Jews. Because it's like their hope was killed, their joy was killed, whatever they had was killed, was killed and put in a tomb. And they had no hope, they had nothing, they were just left like that. And so the only thing they could do, fear got them first. Fear got them, they locked themselves up in a room. The second, a lot of things happened, but I just want to talk about three of them. The second one, they gave up. They gave up, and actually Peter said, I am going back to fishing. I am going back to doing what I was doing before he came. Here I thought my life was going, here I thought things were happening, and all of a sudden this guy that I thought, you know, this is it, he suddenly goes and he dies and he's put in a tomb. I am going back to whatever I was doing. The other thing they did, they doubted. There's Thomas. He doubted when Jesus revealed himself in one of the occasions, and Thomas was told Jesus was here. Remembering all the way the sufferings he went through, he was like, no, I don't think so. He doubted. And what the Lord wants me and you to hear today is that, as I asked you the question before, do you ever face tough situations? I know we all do. I do. It could be at work, it could be at home, it could be financially, it could be anything. It could be anything. Sometimes life is so, we are in such a comfortable zone in one area. We are in such a comfortable zone in our families, in our jobs, in our finances, in whatever the Lord has given you. You are in a comfortable zone. You're just comfortable. You're just there. And then suddenly, something happens. Something happens that ruins that relationship that you have with your family member. Something happens and all the finances you had, the material you had, it goes. All of a sudden, they hire somebody at work and you cannot even, you know, you're not, it's not working. It's not, you cannot even work with them. All of a sudden, something comes and changes the comfort that you had. What do you do from there? What do you do from there? As human beings, I am one, very 100% a human being. You want to first fight for yourself. And I will tell you of a situation. I thank God for my husband. But I think somebody at work that ever in my ever working time, I've never encountered somebody like that. And I remember one time I was just venting to him, and I'm like, I don't know. I really don't know. And knowing my husband, he just said, you really need to thank God for how. I thank what? Because he's like, you know, the Lord position her there so she can make you better. Like, really? And which is true. But the human part in you wants to fight back. You know, she. This week, something just happened, and I was like, the devil must be really, really mad about me. Because the things that she does, I just. Oh my goodness. And the Lord is just telling me just to hang on, don't say something. And something in me wants to go back fishing. Wants to go back to the rosemary, you know, the flesh that I used to be before I got delivered. Something in me wants just to open my mouth and say something. But the Lord is saying, do not. Let me fight for you. And I know in your situations also, you want to act, you want to do things your own. The Bible says, do not lean on your own understanding, but in everything.
Thank you, Jesus. Yes.
In everything, do not act on your own thinking. Do not say, you know, do not act on your own, the logics. Acknowledge the Lord. Let him do it. Let him do it. You want to fight for yourself? Do not. Let him fight for you. Because you know what? He will fold back his hands and let you fight it. And you won't go far. You will not go far. Also, when into situations where tough times come. You fear, you don't know what tomorrow holds. Maybe it's finances, you don't know. You don't know how you will move. You're doubting every word that the Lord says. That's why I sang that song. It is so sweet to trust in the Lord. Sometimes it is not easy, but it's the best thing to do. Because he has spoken his word. He's not a man that he can lie. Whatever he said that he will do, he will do. For us, we might feel like he is taking too long. He is not going the way that we want. I will tell you, in that situation at work, he's not going the way that I want, but you know, let him handle it. I'm just letting him handle it. I know you can point at situations and you can see they are not going the way you think that they should go, but the mind of the Lord is way, way above our thinking. His ways are not our ways at all. And he does things his way because he sees the end from the beginning. For us, we just see this little situation here. But he is seeing the end of it. That's why the Bible also, I believe it says, do not fix your eyes on the current, on what you can see. Because whatever you can see, the trouble that you're seeing right now, the challenges, the tough situation that has come to you or will come to you, it is temporal. But whatever the Lord is doing behind the scenes,
yes,
that is eternal.
Thank you, Jesus.
He is fixing things. It might seem like it's taking too long. It's taking too long for the Lord to fix this relationship with my family member. I have tried things and I have tried this and I have tried this. I have prayed and it seems like it's taking too long. It is so sweet to trust in the Lord. Do not give up. Also, the word also says that he keeps in perfect peace. He whose mind is steadfast in him. We have to let our minds off of the situation, whatever the tough situation it is, let the Lord handle it. Fix your mind upon the Lord.
Yes.
Because what the devil comes to do is just have you so concentrated on that thing that you cannot see anything else. You cannot see what the Lord is saying, you cannot see what the Lord is doing, you cannot hear what he is saying. But he wants you to focus on him. Fix your eyes on him. Let him handle whatever it is. Let him handle it. Do not try to handle it yourself. Do not try to go back to fishing. Do not try to go back to whatever you used to be. You know, if you try, if you are having a relationship issue, do not let the flesh take over. Let the Lord handle that. Follow his word. Sometimes it's not easy. He's telling you to be the, to you know, if he's telling you to go and approach that situation or that person in his way, in his word, and you're feeling there's something in you, there's a pride in you, there's a flesh that is telling you, do not. But just obey the word of the Lord. Because he knows what he is doing. He knows why he's telling you that. He knows. He knows. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
The other thing that I want us to look at is when tough times come, not to fear, not to doubt, but obey. The chapter that we read, it said that they were asked to wait. To wait in Jerusalem,
yes,
for the gift that the Father promised. And the gift came. The gift was the Spirit. They obeyed. Amen? And when the Spirit of the Lord came, every fear, every doubt, whatever they had, when the Spirit of the Lord came, it took care of that. They did not let God lock themselves up again. They went out speaking in tongues and declaring the wonders and the works of the Lord. They did not fear. They did not fear anybody. They did not fear death. And we know that they all died fighting for this gospel. You know why? Because they obeyed. They waited in the room. They did not leave. Even when they tried, he brought them back. Like when they went back fishing, they obeyed and came back and waited. waited in Jerusalem for the gift, the comforter that Jesus had promised him. And when the Holy Spirit came, it made all the difference. Whatever the Lord is telling you, I'm encouraging you to please obey. Please obey the Lord. Obey whatever He is telling you. You do not know when you obey, whatever He will bring, you do not know the difference it's going to make.
Yes.
Not just now, but eternally. Not just for you, but for generations to come.
Mm-hmm.
Obey. Obey the word of the Lord. He knows what He is doing. He is not a man. Thank God He is not like me. He is not like you. He is mighty, He is all powerful, and He is able.
Yes.
And I thank the Lord for what our brother said, that He has a remedy for every situation.
Yeah.
He has a remedy for the situation that you are facing. But for you to get the remedy, for that remedy to work, you have to work with Him.
Mm.
Don't do things your own way. Do not disobey Him. Hear what He is saying, and things will work out.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Do not also let the enemy take the upper hand. Because at that time, you're very vulnerable. You're very vulnerable to anything. And He knows. The devil knows. He knows you are open to anything. He can throw in something. And I remember about 2 years back, I preached a message here on something that I was going through. And something that I had fought probably for a year. And that was, I had some unforgiveness in me. And I knew I should forgive, and I used to pray, God, please take this away. Just take it away. And I just find myself in the same hole. And you know, that's a door that I opened for the devil. And when you open a door for the devil, he's not just going to come in with one thing. He's going to bring a lot. He's going to bring all himself.
Yes, amen.
But I reached a point where the Lord healed my heart. I reached a point where the Lord healed my heart, and I was able to let go.
Yes.
I was able to let go. Do not let the enemy take the upper hand. Do not let him, just thinking it's just a little unforgiveness or a little anger or a little whatever it is you're hanging on to.
Mm-hmm.
He's going to come full swing. He will bring stuff that you didn't think he would.
Mm-hmm.
That's the devil. He will do that. Do not give him any foothold. Do not. Whatever it is, whatever situation it is, whatever tough times will get you, do not give the devil a chance at all. Because when you give him a mile, he takes, he goes and goes and goes, and you'll find yourself in places that you didn't think he would. The last thing I would want to encourage you to do is also let the Lord have His way. Let Him have His way. Let Him have His way. I'm reminded of Abraham when he was given his son at his old age. The son, first of all, was a miracle for him to have Isaac. And here he is so thankful. Thank you, Lord, for this baby you've given us in our old age. Thank you for this miracle. And here he comes, he says, sacrifice that to me. Give me that which you're so thankful of, that miracle that I gave you, give it back to me. And Abraham did not fight back. He went all the way, he took his son and laid him on the altar, and he was just ready, and the Lord spoke. And great things happened after that. Do not hold on. If the Lord is telling you to do something, let Him have His way. Let Him have His way. He knows what He is doing. He knows why He's telling you to do what He's telling you to do.
Yes.
Yours is just to follow Him, to let Him have His way, to obey Him, and let Him lead you wherever He wills. Because He will not lead you into any darkness. He will not lead you into a hole. He knows what He is doing. He has a good plan for you. He has a good purpose for you.
Mm-hmm.
Do not get discouraged Do not give up, do not fear. When the Lord tells you this is the way, follow it. Sometimes, I think most of the times when He tells you to follow this road, it's not easy. But the thing is, you're not walking alone. We are walking with the Lord. He is enabling us. When He is telling you, you can do it, it's not by your own power. It is by His power.
Yes.
When He tells you that you can forgive, it's not you by your own power.
That's right.
But it is Him by His power. When He's telling you to love that person, He is telling me right now to love that person, even when they are so unlovable, it's not me doing it. It's just letting Him do it through me. When He is telling you to give to that needy person, and you're thinking, I don't have anything for myself, it's not you giving, it's letting Him use you to touch that life.
Yes.
Let us yield ourselves to Him. And I'm also, thank you Lord, I'm also remembering the other, someone I preached like 2 or 3 months ago, about when not letting the circumstances that we have magnify the situations that we have to a point where we are not seeing what God is doing. And that was on the story of Ruth and Naomi when they were in the land of the Moab, and they were going back. She did not know, taking Ruth with her back, it was such a great miracle. All Naomi was seeing was the trouble that she lost her husband and she lost her 2 sons. And when the people came and said, oh, is that Naomi? They said, do not call me that. Call me Mara, because the Lord
has dealt
with me. Yeah, you know, she just saw the bad situation that was surrounding her. She did not see Ruth. She did not say, hey, I lost my husband and my 2 sons, but God gave me. No, 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 she did not say that. And that's what I think I'm all coming to. Do not let the situations that are coming into your life, the tough situations, just pull you down. Do not let them just pull you down. Do not let the devil just make you focus your mind on it, that there is nothing else you're seeing. You know that Jesus had warned the disciples, He had told them, I am going, but I'm not going to leave you like orphans.
Yes.
And I'm going to send you a comforter. And He did. We are not alone. He has sent us a comforter. He is with us.
Yes.
The Lord is with us in this journey, whether we face tough times or not, He is with us. Whatever the situation is, He will not leave us alone. He will not forsake us. He will not. When He's telling you to do something difficult, just do it. Just do it. Just go to that family member that you haven't spoken in 10 years. If He's telling you to, just go. Just do it. However tough it is, just lay the pride down. Lay every flesh down and just do it. It might be tough. They might ignore you. They might tell you, forget it. Just, you know. But just be obedient. You have no clue. Absolutely no clue what that will do. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Let us obey the Lord. He has called us into this journey to live it abundantly.
Yes.
But we live like we are
hopeless.
Exactly. Hopeless. Hopeless. But that's not the reason why God called you. I don't believe that's the reason why God saved me. He did not hang on that tree that I may live hopelessly. But He says that I came that you may have life and have it abundantly.
Yeah.
If somebody is going to tell me that I'm going to give you abundant food, I'm expecting loads and loads and trucks. That's my definition of abundant. A lot.
Yes.
If Jesus died for me to have abundant life, I should have abundant life. However, you interpret it. I don't think abundant means little. Or diminished, or just little, however you define little. I don't think abundant means that. It means living life in fullness, not just in one area, but in every area. Amen?
Hallelujah.
But we got to obey the Lord. Let Him have His way. Let Him have His way. Let Him have His way. Lay every pride down. Lay every flesh down, every flesh weighs down. Do not lean on your own understanding. Do not do things in your own thinking, but let him lead you. Amen?
Amen.
And he is leading you to the right way. Hallelujah.
Amen.
He is leading you to the right way. We don't know. We don't know where. We can only imagine, and we have faith that this church is going to do great things. We have faced tough times. We can write a book, books. But we have to hang on. Praise the Lord. And
Hallelujah.
We will continue.
Yeah.
We're not giving up.
Yes.
We will continue hanging on. We will continue obeying and staying as the Lord has said. He said, wait, and we'll continue doing that. Wait.
Yes.
The disciples waited, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon them, and they did the exploits. We are going to wait and rise up and walk. Praise
yes.
the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And we know the Lord will bring the gift that he has promised, and we will do exploits for the glory of God.
Mm.
We are going to obey, 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 and let the Lord have his way.
Mm.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Have your way, Lord. Have your way.
Hallelujah.
Have your way.
Thank you, Lord, for your word this morning.
to us. And as my wife was ministering through the Spirit of God, I feel that you have a situation in your life of unforgiveness. It's time to let it go in the name of Jesus. Maybe there are people that you have not spoken to in years, or the enemy is trying to block that. May the Lord help us to be vessels of mercy and forgiveness. Let God be exalted even as he allows and takes over those hard situations and roots them out. Because he has said, you shall receive power, which is dunamis. Dunamis.
Amen.
All right?
As well.
Dunamis. Dynamite. Control power. Not just, we are trying to go to that place, Iraq, to look for weapons of mass destruction, but we do have a dunamis power. Otherwise, it's the power that helps us do what is impossible. That is to live unselfishly. Otherwise, it would be very hard to do that without the enabling power, the enabling. I remember when I was being ordained, they used to ask me a question, and the answer would be, yes, I would do it through the enabling grace. Empowering grace, the dunamis, the power that is there. The power to live unselfish life, the power to forgive. And I'm beginning to pray and seek the Lord. I've been having that in my heart, that God is going to visit our families. Relationships will be restored. Doesn't matter what has happened, if we have the dunamis, we have the power. And we shall begin to speak life. Our words will be life. When we find dry bones, we are not going to step on them and say, oh, they are gone. No. We are going to say they can come back. Yes. We are not going to bury them. You know, they were in a hurry to bury Lazarus. But thank God. I am so excited and grateful. Do you want to come and give us a benediction, Jay? God will continue to raise us ministers, preachers. Who knows? Lucy might be next to preach. So I'll be getting ready.
Yeah.
Amen.
Get that. party. I mean, that's still obedience, but if you can't obey the Lord, I mean the law, which is so minute, if you don't start from the very beginning, how will you be able to obey the Lord? It calls for grace, it calls for a lot of prayer. So I would ask all of us to... It's a heavy load. It is. And I ask the church to get some time and meditate on these words. Because you know, it's our own blessings. We're trying to have our own blessings in this situation, in any situation. And that's not, we are going to pray. Our heads for a word of prayer.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes, Heavenly Father, as we gather this time at the end of the service, we want to thank you for the word that you've given us to us. Lord, we as a commandment to obey your word, Heavenly Father. We pray that you may be able to enable us to stick to your word, Heavenly Father. Yes. We pray for family members who are on the church today. We pray for our friends. We proclaim this church, Heavenly Father.
Yes.
God bless you all. Thank you for being here. As you love one another, the service has just begun.